that you paid will be doubled by Louise. So, yeah. And I'd like to remind you, if you can, turn off the ringers off of your cell phones, please, because that would be quite helpful so we don't have too many disruptions. And now, the moment you've all been waiting for. The grand queen of all queens, reigning above Wendy, member of the Order of Quebec, member of the Order of Canada, New York Times best-selling author, winner of the Bloody Dagger, the Arthur, the Dilly, the Barry, the Agatha, the one and only, the incomparable Louise Penny. Come from Camlin's, just up the street. They're on sale. The price tags are still on them if you want them.
The guy is just like, oh, the table. Yeah.
There's the price tags right there. I don't, if you want to, your mic
so you
good?
Got to get to hear me. Because what I'm saying is brilliant.
And there are also people, I think, watching this over at the Relais, is that right?
Yes,
over at the restaurant
we have
across the way.
A whole bunch of people at the restaurant, the Relais, watching, who are also getting their copies of the new book of the Kingdom of the Blind.
They're the people. You guys were the fastest. You got in, and they're sort of the overflow. However, they're the ones who are now getting drunk on red wine and eating steak frites. So we have to figure out who actually won this.
Yes.
Who are the lucky ones?
Yeah. I'm so happy we're here at Theatre Lac-Brome.
Yes.
Which really is sort of important to me as a, you know, our hometown, home-based theater. And you had Gamache visit the Knowlton Playhouse in one book.
I did. Yeah. That's right.
And he sat in the front row somewhere.
He did.
He said, it wasn't during a show. He came in to drop somebody off.
Yeah.
And it was Nature of the Beast.
It was.
I think, right?
Yep. Found some.
And he sits in the front row to think about the case. So you're sitting, Cotton, you're probably sitting right where Gamache was sitting.
Cotton Amers, my neighbor down the hall. Playing in the role of Armand Gamache today, we have Madame Cotton Amers.
But these locations, these, we call them inspirations, these places in the townships, they're exciting for us who live here to think that Gamache... But for you, as characters, as these places, and how do you feel about these real places as being characters?
Well, do you know, one of the mistakes I made early on, and something if I could go back and redo it, I would change, is when I was writing Still Life, I knew that I wanted Three Pines to be fictional. And I'm glad I did that for all sorts of reasons. But I also decided that, aside from situating it very clearly in the eastern townships and in Quebec, I wanted all the other villages to be pretty much fictional. And so I made up Saint-Rémy and Williamsburg, which was really Knowlton, and Saint-Rémy is Sutton. And then as I got further into it, and I think as they became more popular and more people were asking, where's this and where's that, I realized that I had actually made a mistake and that I wished I had used Knowlton and Sutton and the real names. So now I've actually begun putting those in. I talk about Cowansville, and I actually talk about Knowlton and Sutton and some of those. So Saint-Rémy has sort of disappeared. It's a great thing being God. Not so good for the citizens of Saint-Rémy, but... So no, it's really important to me that there is a very keen sense of place, and that comes through using some of the real places, the monastery. There must be people here who are, how many are here for the first time? Oh, wonderful.
At least about
Oh,
half.
Excellent. Because there are, I know that there's a Three Pines Inspirations map, and the monastery is well worth visiting. It's inspired. The monks want it very clear that it is not based on an actual event. If you go, you have to try the cheese. So it's really important to me that these places exist, and that I love where I live. And I suspect all of you love where you live. And it was just really important to me to communicate that love, and what I feel is special. And what I felt was special wasn't necessarily the trees and the flowers and the grass, because every place has trees and flowers and grass. It was that sense of community and of belonging and of welcome and of acceptance that I felt here as an Anglo coming into Francophone Quebec. I've never felt unwelcome or less of a citizen, and I needed to communicate that sense of home.
You really have communicated that sense of home on Facebook, and right from the very beginning, you were a big Facebook advocate. You were always said nobody works harder than Louise at you know, writing these posts and getting really connecting with the fans and.
But you know, it's interesting you say that, because I don't know how many of you followed when I was just doing the blog. Does anyone remember that?
Mm. Yes.
Apparently not.
Yeah. No.
I did the blog for 3 or 4 years. I don't know that anyone does blogs anymore. But then I stopped doing them. The blog was interesting, though, because it was actually really more like an essay. Quite
like
long.
Like a newsletter.
That's very much
like your newsletter.
That's right. I would talk about the travels and what Michael and I were doing and all sorts of things. It went into much more depth than Facebook could. And my publishers at one stage said, you know, you really should think about Facebook. I said, I don't want to do Facebook. You know, it's just, it's both invasive and banal, and I don't want to do it. So I dug my heels in and was soon proven that I was yet again wrong. Because I started doing Facebook and realized that there's something really special about it, more so than the blog, because there's an almost instant rapport and reaction from the readers. I don't often respond to the comments, but I read all the comments, and that means a lot, and it has meant a lot. It has become not simply a marketing tool, which I found interesting, because of course it started off like that. And then it became so much more, and there's a question that some friends ask each other, like, when did the cucumber become a pickle? At what stage does that irrevocable change happen? And I couldn't tell you where that line was crossed with Facebook, where it really stopped being a tool to market the books and became a community unto itself. But it has happened, and it's become, proved as I went through the dementia with Michael, extremely and profoundly important to me to not feel alone. And people shared extraordinary things with me, and it was and continues to be one of the pillars of my life. I mean, who would have thought? Facebook.
Well, and for all of us too, for all of the fans who are part of your community, we all feel so much more connected. I mean, friends that we've met on Facebook, and you know, we're friends because of you. And because of that tool.
Well, you and I'd be friends anyway, wouldn't we?
Well, I don't know.
I don't even know who he is.
Yeah,
okay. Well, let me ask you, how many of you are Facebook, follow me on Facebook? Oh, yes, quite a few. That's interesting.
Who doesn't? Get their names. Wendy,
lock
get their
the
names.
Door. Sign them up.
Wendy's going to be monitoring Facebook to see if there are any really good questions. I'm reminding her. Any really good questions that come from Facebook or people commenting or where they're from?
No, we don't want them to hear the comments.
No, well. So let's talk about the book. Let's talk about Kingdom of the Blind. I wanted to start by talking about Myrna, because this book really shows us Myrna in a whole new way. What was it like sort of delving into Myrna in this book?
Well, and it's difficult to talk about the book without giving away too much, so I won't give away anything that isn't already on the flap or you haven't read in perhaps some pre-pub reviews. I want to back up a little bit in order to answer that question. I wasn't going to write the book this year. I was going to take a year off to just sort of regroup and reconnect with friends and reconnect with myself and the new life. And then I discovered that actually I did want to write. But one of the things that prompted it was in working, I'm one of the, in Quebec they call them liquidators, but it's executors of Michael's will. And I was sitting with the accountant, and he mentioned that, we were talking about liquidators or executors, and he mentioned that, you know, you can name anyone as the executor of your will. I said, no, that can't be right. He said, oh, yeah, you can name the Pope. I said, really? The Queen? I'm taking down the Queen. And he said, not to say that they're actually going to do it, but you can name anyone. And that sort of began to percolate a little bit, and I began to think, well, like so many of the books start with that question of what if? Suppose, what if? And so that began a train of thought that ended up with one of the main storylines in Kingdom of the Blind, in which three people are named in an elderly woman's will, none of whom knew her, and only two of whom know each other. And one is Gamache, one is this young man, a carpenter, and the third one, I was trying to figure out, I knew I wanted it to be one of the villagers, and I was trying to figure out who. So I would walk around and place different villagers in. Suppose it's Gabri. How would that work? How would that play out? No, that wouldn't work. Suppose it's Clara. How would that work? So I sort of auditioned them all. But as soon as I slotted in Myrna, it worked. And so now it's Myrna, the bookstore owner, Gamache, and this young man who have to deal with a very odd will. So that it was fun to explore Myrna more and see her in different situations. It was important for me that she not be like a third wheel, that she be a strong, if both physically strong, but also intellectually strong member of this trio.
It's really fascinating seeing these characters develop all through the whole series and sort of watch them. I mean, you immediately love Gamache, I think, right from the start. And even that this small little bit of when Gamache finds out that there's a murder in Three Pines, he goes to a map and tries to find Three Pines on the map. And they're just there, just like, you know, knowing now what's going to happen and all the adventures and everything, just that just gives me shivers. But we love him right from the beginning. But Beauvoir.
How many here like Beauvoir? How many of you? Woo, really?
But did you at the beginning?
Yeah, how many of you at the beginning liked Beauvoir? Ah, only a few.
Yeah.
Right. How many women here would marry Beauvoir? How many men would marry Beauvoir?
Yeah.
How about Gamache? Yeah. How many of you would marry Gamache?
Yes, and he shows up in town with his fancy shoes and fusses about the fact that he's got the wrong shoes in the country and who likes the country and all this.
And this is in Still Life.
Yes,
at the beginning.
Way back
and
at the beginning.
And couldn't understand, I mean, he spoke some English, but just didn't understand emotionally the Anglo reaction to things. And as a result, really did not like them very much.
But that journey that you brought him on, it's just amazing. And
Thank
did you,
you
plan that journey? Did you? Or did it evolve?
I'd
did
like
it
to
just
say
try?
Yes. Because I think that puts me in a better light than bumbling along. No, I didn't. I didn't realize. I knew that I wanted the characters to evolve and to have a life. And that's also why I started them off not really too young, because I wanted them also to have a history that we're not aware of when we first meet them. And so that their lives move forward, but we also get to see what had happened in their earlier lives. So it was interesting. That's one of the challenges when you're writing a series, I think, is to have a sense of where the plot is going and some idea of where the characters are going to evolve without having such a close grip on them that you strangle them. So there needs to be that room for some breathing and some grace in there and some ideas that surprise even me. And that happened with Beauvoir, but once, and I won't go into because I know some of you probably haven't read the whole series, but after book six, Bury Your Dead, we're describing what happened in the factory. You know, these small things, it's so interesting to me that some things that are so tiny can have ultimately a profound effect on, for me, the books. I was at an apartment that we've since given up, but had in Montreal, waiting for the elevator, and I had Tic Tacs, and I put a couple of Tic Tacs in my hand, and there was a mirror there as I waited, and I put them in my mouth, and I saw myself popping them back. And I thought, that looks like pills. It looked like someone popping pills. And then at that instant, it all came together I want to write a scene where that would happen, and if that happened, where would that, what if? And so by the time I got on the elevator, the whole Beauvoir storyline for books forward was pretty well set. Oh, so it's interesting, isn't it?
That whole relationship between Gamache and Jean-Guy is, of course, developed and such a huge and important story, and an incredible story. And we have a little bit of a surprise. Do you think this is a good time to sort of?
I think this is a great time to do it. Can I just set it up a little?
Yes, please.
Both the books are about many things, of course. Probably least of all death and murder. They're really about life and friendships and community, our belonging, and love in all the forms it takes. And one of the forms and one of the most profound loving relationships in the books is Beauvoir and Gamache, that father-son relationship that they had. I was at a performance last weekend. It was just last weekend,
last
wasn't
weekend?
It? Danny was in it, Lucy was in it, a whole bunch of villagers were in it,
the whole town.
Those who weren't in it were in the audience. Yeah. I was in the audience, and
you were over there. Someone sitting in your seat. Too. Gamache was there. Louise Penny was up there.
Gum under it. And what it was a review of Broadway hits. So just a whole bunch, South Pacific, and a bunch of others, including Les Misérables. And one of the songs from Les Misérables, when I looked at it, it suddenly came back to me that's where the relationship of Gamache and Beauvoir came from. And I saw this, Les Misérables, 1985 or so. So this was 20 years before I started writing the books. But I tucked it away because it was such a moving relationship that I wanted to write. I knew when I started writing the books that I wanted it to be a loving relationship between these two men. And what we've done is we've asked Rob, who sang the song, to sing it for you now. This is where, this is the genesis of the relationship between Gamache and Beauvoir. And it's from Les Misérables, and it's called Bring Him Home. And it's sung from the point of view of Gamache. I wonder if before we actually begin, I'm sorry, Rob, we should say, just set it up a little bit, that this is, they're about to start the battle at the barricades in the French Revolution, and both these characters are involved, the older man and the younger man, are about to enter into battle, so that's when this song happens. And then, no.
My prayer.
afraid. Let him rest. Heaven blessed. Bring him home. Bring him home. Bring him home. He's like the son I might have known. If God had granted me a son, the summers die one by one. How soon they fly on and on. And I am old and will be joy. He is young. He is only a boy. You can take, you can give.
That's Rob Oslington, and that was John Barr on the piano.
That's just beautiful. Yeah, it was just nice. Now, I wish we could get you and Lucy to sing.
Oh, no, you don't want that at all. You know, Lucy needs to do a lot more drinking, I think, before that.
More drinking, as yes. opposed to what you've already done.
Yes. So, the kingdom of the blind, where the one-eyed man is king, mm-hmm. is that the,
it's
is
Erasmus.
That the quote? Erasmus, yes. Do you know the whole name? His whole name, I had to look it up.
There's another name?
Desiderius
Erasmus, like
Erasmus? Rotodamarus, or something like that. I'm probably saying it completely wrong.
He's just making it
yeah,
up
I'm
at
making
this point.
It's like, so why this quote? What did you
find? Again, it wasn't initially called Kingdom of the Blind. I can't remember now what I initially called it. I often have titles that then change as the book goes along. But there's a scene in there, and I won't describe it, where it's a confrontation. And someone has someone else up against a wall, and they snarl in their ear because the person doesn't know who it is, and they say, "I'm the one-eyed man." But you know they have absolute vision; they're not actually one-eyed. And then they leave, and so there's some question as to what that was supposed to mean. But this is what it means. But the book is also—I mean, that's why. I mean, I would never have called it Kingdom of the Blind because of that scene. and again, it came out of the blue. I didn't expect the character to say, I'm the one-eyed man at that point, but as soon as the character did, I just sort of sat back and thought about it a little bit and looked up the Erasmus quote. I mean, I knew what the quote was, but just wanted to confirm. Then I started to think, and I realized, my God, that's what the book's about, all the way through. And this happens about two-thirds of the way through the book. I thought, my God, the book, this is what the book's about. How could I not have consciously known that, that the book is about blindness? Not physical blindness, but all the ways that we are blind, all the things we miss, all the preconceptions we have, all the blind spots, the willful blindness, the unwillful.
Or in hidden talents, or things mm-hmm. that we didn't know that are uncovered, or important things that are now important that
that's right, that lie in the dark. Yeah. Yeah.
There's that sense of home and sense of place and family and community is very important. Mm-hmm. You start this with a broken home, with this sort of a home that's in disrepair.
Right. Right. Yeah. That was, again, I don't want to talk too much about it. And this is the, like, the, just in the very first two paragraphs or so, the first page. But yeah, it was again, the books are, one of the things I like to bring to it is that sense of duality of our public face and our inner thoughts, the gap between what we're feeling and what we actually say, between the beauty of Three Pines and what actually happens behind the closed doors. So it's the light and the dark, the yin and yang, the duality. And so I wanted to create this scene that is, you know, relatively beautiful, but have this broken house. Oh, I know what the book was initially called. It was called, I think it was called The Crooked Mile, because the house was crooked. Then I realized that was kind of stretching the point. It's because the house is crooked, I don't have to call the book.
You do really draw on poetry, and mm-hmm. very often Auden comes mm-hmm. into a lot of the books. What is it about what is it about poetry that feeds you, that gives you this?
What I love about poetry, and I read quite a lot of it, but I don't read widely, because when I say that I read poetry and people say, oh, have you read this African poet? Oh, no. Have you read this person? Have you read that? No. No, there's 10 poets that I read over and over again. Not that I'm not open to others, but it just seems to be my go-to poets, including a lot of Ruth's poetry is from Margaret Atwood. And you have that book, don't
yes,
you?
I do.
It's from Morning in the Burned House. It's now available at the Brome Lake Books. Do you have the other one too, the Marilyn Plessner?
Not at the moment. But no.
No,
we have had The Surprise okay. by Joy. Is the
the book is Vapor Trails, the other one. I think it's because great poetry, there's a lot of poetry that I read that I don't really understand. If someone says, what does that mean? I don't think I could actually tell you, but I understand it inside, in my heart. And I think the same is true with these books. I think with the Gamache books, if you read it only with your head, you're only getting half the book. I sort of feel like you have to bring it in first through the chest and then move up. They have to make sense and be rational, make sense intellectually, but really the meat and potatoes of it is the intuitive, is it what you feel about the books. And that's what I also get out of poetry and get out of, in particular, Auden.
But you do lead us on through these little threads going, oh, intellectually, she's taking us this way, and nope, she drops it. Tricks us and goes somewhere else.
Sneaky.
Yes, you are very sneaky. Yeah, but we love it. Should we take some questions from
I'd love to.
From the audience, or from Wendy? Did you how have you had with Facebook? Have we had
so far not a lot of questions, but a lot of greetings. People love just singing. People best wishes from all over different places.
Oh, great!
Fantastic!
Excellent! That's nice. Which, speaking of which, there are people here, I think, from quite a distance. Can you sort of shout out where you're from?
New Hampshire.
Great, Rhode Island, New Hampshire. Vermont?
Huh?
Oh, no. No. Really? Oh, yeah, that was Lucy. That's not fair. Yeah, up there.
Utah.
Did you come here specifically for this? You did? Where are you from?
Utah.
Oh, you're from Utah. Did you come specifically for this?
Yes.
Ah! Geez, now the pressure's really on.
Should we take a couple of their questions?
Yes, but again, I just want to say, because the books are so interrelated, if you could try not to have any spoilers, sort of keep in mind, you know, try not to ask why did you make so-and-so the murderer.
Yeah. We might need a little bit of help here. Lucy, if you can help relaying things down. We have a question way up in the back, someone with a white. Do you ever get ahead of yourselves with the characters?
Not necessarily in terms of like, oh no, that needs to happen in the next book or the next book, but certainly within a book. In fact, I'm writing the next book now and this morning. This morning I had a scene with Armand and Ren Marie, and it was definitely ahead of where it should be, but I'm not totally clear where it should be. So yes, I did. I sort of took that section out and put it down to the side, and when it's right, it will go in. But so far not. I don't have anything happening to the characters in a book that I think, oh no, it'd be better 3 or 4 books ahead. Or yes.
We have a question here on the stage, just on the side.
Yes.
So the question, just to relay it through the microphones, could you talk about the relationship between Jean-Guy and Ruth?
Right. That again was one of those that just was not planned. It just started evolving that way because both of them have kind of a caustic tongue and they sort of leaned into each other, but could take it as well. And there was this sort of sparring, but it couldn't be just that. There had to be affection. I think one of my favorite scenes in all the books, and again, this wasn't planned, was when it was in How the Light Gets In. You probably know what I'm going to say, with the duck, where Jean-Guy is sitting on the bench and Ruth joins him. And gives him Rosa. And I think that obviously was symbolic of the love that she felt for him and for Rosa. And so it felt like something that had to happen, this relationship between two fairly broken people, that they would understand each other at a level that other people may not understand.
Yes. Another question?
How long do they live, by
the
way?
Oh, Rosa's going on for a long time. So the question is, with all your traveling, do you ever wake up saying, where are you?
No, I sometimes, who am I?
Who are you?
That's never a good question to have to ask yourself. No, I don't. But you know, when I initially, for the first 3 or 4 books, it felt, particularly certainly the first couple, it felt like magic. I didn't really know how I had written Still Life. Then I had to write the second book, which I can get into if you're interested. And then the third and the fourth, and I had contracts and expectations and people paying attention. And I felt that nothing should change. I was like one of those athletes, you know, who doesn't shave after, you know, because they're on a winning streak and they don't change their socks and things get pretty disgusting. Well, fortunately for Michael, I didn't take it to that length for 3 years not changing the socks, but I felt it had to be the same laptop, it had to be exactly in that location, right in front of the fireplace, in that house. I couldn't write anywhere else. So we're pretty much chained there. And then that evolved a little bit as I got a little bit more confident and then was able to do more traveling. And now I take the laptop with me and I'm able to write wherever I am. I think because Three Pines, people ask, you know, does Three Pines exist? Which I remember the first couple of times they asked that, and Michael and I were living up on Mount Echo, which is this road up here, quite far, closer to Sutton, sort of in the middle of nowhere. And I said to him, you know, these people are coming over from Germany to find, they want to stay in the bistro. They want to know where it is. And I said, I think, honey, we're going to have to open a B&B. And, you know, you can be Olivier, I'll be Gabri. But Three Pines exists in a way that I think is inspired by a whole bunch of places, including Brome Lake and other villages around. But really, Three Pines is a state of mind. It's an allegory. It's a symbol for when we are kind, for when we choose to be decent, which isn't always an easy thing to do. It takes so much more courage to be a nice person, to not enumerate the flaws, which are so obvious, but instead recognize the flaws but choose to highlight the good things. And once that became more apparent to me, I realized that I didn't have to be on the blanket box writing with that laptop exactly in that place, that Three Pines is with me all the time wherever I go. And that's a great comfort.
So is it a good person when you're at a bookstore and someone goes, I'm looking for Three Pines, and go, well, you go up on this dirt road, turn left at the old oak tree, then right, send them on this wild goose chase to the middle of nowhere.
Do you do that?
Oh,
you
never.
Don't do that. The wild duck chase, more like it.
Yeah. Every time we're driving down a dirt road and someone's like stopping and they're looking, we're going, oh, it's another penny pen looking for. Do we have another question?
Huh?
Lucy's picking somebody.
When you write, it is quite a vulnerable state. And I feel like as much as we want to separate ourselves from our characters, that always comes through. How are you able to write about inadequacies and fears and all the things that we see in ourselves that we don't want anyone else to see?
Oh, an interesting question. It was such an honest question, I will give you the honest answer. Because I know this is going to go nowhere else. It's just between us and the world. I don't think this is a huge surprise to some of you here, an alcoholic. And I'm now in recovery and have been for 25 years. And joined a 12-step program. Thanks to a 12-step program that saved my life, along with the higher power and a lot of friends I've met along the way. But I know what despair feels like. I know what it feels like to want to die. I know what it feels like to realize I don't have the courage to do it to myself as much as I wanted to. I know what it felt like to realize that I didn't really want to die, but I didn't know how to live, to feel lost, to feel so broken that I didn't think anyone could ever love me or care about me. And then getting into the 12-step program, that really forced me, because part of the steps and part of the process is to own that. And that the only way to let something go is not to go around it or to deny it, but to go straight through it. And so that gave me an awareness of myself and all my vulnerabilities and all the flaws and all the cracks. And that's why I think I responded so strongly to that Leonard Cohen quote about, you know, ring the bells that still can ring, forget your perfect offering, there's crack in everything, that's how the light gets in. And I was deeply cracked, but that's how the light got in. And if I hadn't been through that dreadful period in my life, I wouldn't be here today. So that's how I can write about our insecurities and all our vulnerabilities and all our fears, because I have them. I have a poster in front of me on the opposite wall where I write. And it's the last words of the poet Seamus Heaney. And on his deathbed, he said to his wife, Noli to Mary. It's only a poet would speak in Latin on his deathbed, right? She had to go look it up. what it means is be not afraid. So I sit there every day and I look at it and I think, I can do this. I can do this. Be not afraid. Because there's a lot to be afraid of. Not necessarily bombs dropping or thank God we live in Canada. And no one's likely to shoot us. But there's a lot of other things to be afraid of, many of our own making, my own making. So that's why I can write about those things. And why I can write about grace, and why I can write about what it's like to come out the other side, to feel hope, that dot in Ruth's eye in Clara's painting. I understand what that is, that just that hint, that suspicion that maybe things aren't that bad. Hope. Can we take?
Oh, a question here.
Sorry, and then we'll take, yes. But let's, can.
Louise, were you conscious of the evolution of Three Pines becoming a therapeutic community for the deported citizens?
Oh. Were you conscious of Three Pines being a therapeutic community for its citizens?
Well, I think I understood what coming here meant to me in terms of finding a community. And so I just sort of assumed that's, and I wanted to create that in Three Pines, that sense of being non-judgmental, of accepting people, warts and all, and how therapeutic that is when you know that you're in a safe place. So yes, I think the Three Pines is remarkable and somewhat magical, not because bad things don't happen. Bad things do happen. What makes it survive is that it accepts those things and can talk about them and embraces people and doesn't shun them. It's a very inclusive community, and that's very healing. Sorry, I interrupted over here.
How did you create the character of Ruth?
How do you create the character of Ruth? Well, Ruth came fairly early on. Of course, all these characters, the main core of the Three Pines characters came before I started writing the books. And the first thing that happened was I created the village. I knew I wanted it to be a safe place. And then after that, the first thing I created was the bookstore, because what's more important than books? That's the main nourishing quality. And then hard on the heels of that was the bistro, because. And then just in case the bistro should run out of croissants, I created the bakery. And then the general store without vegetables. Apparently. Don't seem to be any vegetables in Three Pines. And I created the characters, obviously, because I didn't think the books would be published. I wanted them to be published, or the book to be published. I wanted it to be a series, but, you know, who dares really think is going to happen. You can dream it might, but there was no expectation that it would happen. So I wanted to create a community of characters whose company I would enjoy, because I sort of figured that the writing of it was going to be the only reward I get. So I populated it with a bunch of people I would choose as friends. But after a while, I realized, as I began to think about it more and more, that you know, you really do need a dissenting voice. You need sort of the refusenik. You need the Greek chorus. And I have two people in my life. God. who are Ruth? Interestingly enough, they don't see it. So that's sort of where she came from. What I wanted was, again, that duality. I wanted, most of us have the veneer of civility, and then inside we keep our more rancid thoughts, and thank God we do. Ruth is inside out. So she keeps all of her good thoughts inside, and I wanted to explore that. But her saving grace is the poetry, and the amount of self-awareness she clearly has that comes out in the poetry.
One last question, I think.
Okay. Just
how much of the books do the characters write themselves?
Are you representing the characters in a lawsuit? That would be something, wouldn't it? Taken to court by my characters. There is a certain amount of that, for sure, at this stage in particular. I mean, I'm still in charge, and I know I'm still God, but they get to be the archangels. They're moving up the ranks. What I do know is when I get it wrong. If someone says something that just isn't their voice or isn't right, I know that. But for the most part, it's hard to say. I think at this stage, there's some things that are just natural for the characters to be doing and for their evolution. In this book, and I won't tell you what it is, but there's at least one quite major change for one of the main characters. And that felt like a natural thing for them to be doing. But I'm in charge. I'm God.
Should we check in with Facebook just one last time? Wendy, was there anything that...
Someone's wondering if your earrings are dolphins. They can't quite see.
Oh!
No, they're not dolphins. They're the sort of swirly things. We're going to sell them. Start selling them at the bookstore.
Someone is wondering if you're going to give some updates on some of the characters. For example, how are little Charlie and the wife?
Old Munden. Old Munden and the wife. You know, the difficulty with that, and some people ask about what happened to Miss Jane Neal's house. Yeah. Well, the problem is that I can't mention it without ruining still life. You know, if someone reads this book, and a lot of people will come to Kingdom of the Blind as the first book that they've read, and that's also a challenge, because you have to bring people up to speed without letting too much out, and give enough background, but for those of you who already know it, it can't be boring, and so it takes quite a bit of work to do that. And also to not ruin too much that goes on. But if I talk about Jane Neal's house, that ruins. So the same with Old Munden and the wife, and there are some other characters there that I really can't continue to bring up. I did, I don't know if you remember the asshole saint.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, I've been thinking that I need to bring him back a little bit. He's along the lines of Ruth, you know.
Should we thank the publishers at all? Should we mention them? I don't.
We probably should, because they're probably watching.
Yeah. So Raincoast Books here in Canada, distributed. And Karen Stacey is here today representing Raincoast. And they did, thankfully, the books arrived, and they arrived on time and early, and how, you know, for you guys to get them early.
Mm-hmm, and I also want to mention Minotaur Books. They're my publisher in the United States, part of St. Martin's Press. And my amazing, amazing editor, Hope Dellen, we've worked together for 13 books now, 13 years. Yeah, it's an amazing process. She's remarkable. The other thing I wanted to mention, probably shouldn't call her a thing, is my assistant, Lise, who's here. Lise! Thank you, Lise. Lise is extremely special to me. I found her in the garden. I did.
Under the cabbage leaves.
Oh. And by the compost pile, that's right. Yeah, Lise is a master gardener, and she worked on our gardens, and we got to talking, and over the years, and I realized how remarkable she is, and then I asked, you know, would you like to work part-time for me? And then now, 12 years later, here we're inseparable.
We're going to do a drawing for some prizes and things. Would you like to start us off?
I would love to.
Could we have the fish bowl up here, Winnie? Yes. Oh, we didn't get a picture of everyone with their books. Did you want a shot of the audience holding up
their
books?
Yes, but I think we might need to do something with the lights.
Yeah, could we bring the house lights up a little bit more if possible? And if you could hold up your book covers, everyone will get it. Wow. Nice.
Can we turn that light, I think that's going to be too bright. Yeah. Can we turn off those three lights there?
Bring them down.
Bring them right down. Oh my God, there are people here.
I know. Stage. Fantastic.
Is that good? Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You're going to end up on Facebook.
And so I have lots and lots of things to give away. While Louise starts signing, I think we could start with a map of three pines.
Yes, a map of three pines.
Coveted map. Hard to get these now. If you want.
Oh, the other thing. My God, how could I have forgotten this? Brome Lake Books. We have to thank Danny and Lucy in Brome Lake Books. Woo! And of course, Rob and John as well.
John.
So thank you. So this is for, the map, the world of three pines. All right, it's F10.
F10, so that's your seat number. All right.
Yeah, the seat number, not their name.
Yeah, congratulations. Right. Ben, can you take that? Thank you. So. Thank you so much, Louise. This was fantastic.
You're welcome. Thank you. And thank you all for coming.
Thank
and I'm
you.
Going to, I'm happy to sign all your books. I'm going to be sitting out there, so we're going to do it in some sort of
order. We're going to do it in order, so please stay in your seats, but we have more to give away as well. So we're going to set
Louise on our
way. And I hope
you enjoy Brome Lake while you're here and the whole area.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Right. So we're a small little theater. We don't have, there aren't that many, you know, there aren't really that many of you. So it's not going to take that long for us to get to meet Louise and have some books signed. So we'll just take our time, and we've got some things to give away. I have lots of happy helpers that are going to help me pass things out. I'm going to kind of mention
just in case, a little bit of mix-up with all of our 800 books that we had. But if you happen to have a long slip of paper that was in the back of your book, if we could have that back, there might be three of them. There are three people that might be very appreciative because there were a couple of special slips put in. Well, we actually had a one of the boxes got mixed up. So if you find one of those, that would be appreciated. So we have another. Winnie, can you come up and help me with these things? Here's some posters, so one each. Ben? Oh, some people found their papers?